I feel like I'm a liberator in that sense, to where it's kind of like, it's no longer your story when it happens to me.
Hi, my name is Mrs. Melanin.
And I'm Belief Mel.
And we're here with episode 111 of How Married Are You?
My name is Belief, this is Yvette, and we've been married 10 years, live in California, got 4 kids. Relationships are scary, and it's very necessary that we share our love, our struggles, and we ask how married are you? Every Tuesday and Thursday, shoddy. If you're listening, you're in a wedding party. It's okay if you wanna put your hands up. We got the questions, you got the answers. It's chocolate baby story time. Chocolate baby story time.
It's chocolate baby story time.
1, 2, 3, and
it's chocolate baby story time.
All right, I got one. All right, so we've had like this, these ants that have been like everywhere, all over the outside of the house. And I think when it starts to get colder, they start to find their way inside of the house. I don't know how that happens, but I just know every fall, it gets crazy. Mm-hmm. So I was putting down these like ant poison traps, which is like the little tarot things, like little sweet fluid, and we take it back to the queen and everybody dies. So I'm putting them out there and the kids are watching and I'm like, please don't touch these. Don't let anybody touch these. Your friends, nobody touches these things. And then I was like, I'm just placing them all around the yard. And then Uriah goes, well, I need to see where all of them are. And I was like, why? He's like, just in case I make a mistake and drink it. And I was like, why would you make a mistake and drink it? He was like, Dad, I just need to know where all of them are just so I won't get in trouble. I was like, why would you get in trouble? Just don't touch it. He was like, well, show me where all of them are. And I was like, why would you drink it? And he was like, just in case. He's like, I don't know. He's like, I might forget.
Ryobo.
Man.
Ryobo.
That's a true story, man. I don't know. Some of y'all might try to make it seem like I'm lying or I'm gassing, but nah, that's truth.
That's so funny. Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
What does it mean when you say gassing?
It's like when you hyping it up.
That's, you know what I thought. Okay, just making sure. I knew that, y'all. I just wanted to make sure. My chocolate baby story has to do with today. The kids were, so we had a little shenanigans for like the kids with their costumes for Halloween or whatever.
Shindig.
What did I say?
Shenanigans.
Anywho, we did that, and so today we had a bunch of balloons that we needed to get rid of. And instead of having the kids kicking them around, I was like, well, let's just pop them. I was going to pop them, but Glen suggested that the kids pop them, and they did. And so they got little thumbtacks and just popped them all. But then the cleanup afterwards was so adorable because all four of the kids were working together to make it, like, pick it up. So Theo was taking, so we used a little balloon strips to, like, make a little balloon arch or whatever. So Theo was taking the balloons out of the balloon arch strip, and Uzi or Anaya was picking him up, giving them to Uzi, and Uzi was giving them to Uriah to throw in the trash. It was just a whole system that they had worked out, and it was cute. I loved seeing it.
Yeah, that's chocolate baby story time, guys. We do that every episode where we just basically talk about a story with the kids. And that's what we do. So on Tuesdays, we take questions and kind of talk about some dilemmas you guys may have called in, emailed in, and we try to help you figure out your issue through our limited expertise, because we are not therapists or counselors, but we do try to help. So I think we're not going to talk about like where we've been. We're just going to get through this episode and maybe talk about it next episode.
Yeah, I was going to say, though, that we have sat down to record 3 episodes since the last time you have
seen us
or and heard us. All of those episodes ended up in dispute. So
yeah,
that's just a little segue.
And you guys know we usually argue on camera or argue on the podcast. So, you know, if we
didn't share it,
it was bad. Mm-hmm. It was really, really, really bad. So anyway.
Yeah. But we're here today. So we'll see if we make it.
Yeah, we'll see if this one makes it out.
If we make it through there. So we have a couple of voicemails this morning. Here is the first one.
Hi, Glen and Yvette. This is my second voicemail because I really did not like the first one that I sent. My name is Kyra. I am a 28-year-old young professional, but young, it's kind of subjective. I mean, I'm still in my 20s, but yeah. So I'm out here in this single life, and I guess I kind of wanted to know, get your take on balancing moving professionally or just trying to get things done for your own personal life and your singleness, but also, I guess, balancing, say, that transition into friendship. So to kind of get some context, my last two relationships, which have been like 3 or 4 years apart from each other, they were kind of big deals for me. I'm a type of person that don't really search for relationships. I make guy friends. Usually they're more interested in me a lot more times than I am of them, although I love, you know, making connections. I'm more of an introvert, but when I do make connections, I just love it. That being said, like, I have a problem where when I'm single, I'm very single and I try to focus on my stuff. But when I'm involved with someone or really interested, it's a struggle for me to focus. I have a hard time focusing any way and being a non-procrastinator. Like, I work very hard to be productive. And just to even take an inch, make a step in the right direction half the time. But I feel like each time, those last two especially, because I felt kind of, you know, it was a little bit deep, had a stronger attachment to those people. I jumped into it and lost my focus. And I think that also contributed to why those didn't work out. The long distance one was 2 years, and the one that was a lot closer to me within the same city where I saw the guy all the time. We had known each other for over a year, but relationship lasted 3 months, and I broke it off. I don't know if that makes a difference, but I just kind of wanted to see what your thoughts on, like, that transition, kind of living in the singleness and just being, you know, what's healthy. Just your thoughts on it. But thank you, guys. I love your podcast. How married are you? And Belief in Fatherhood is dope.
Okay. I don't really understand that question at all. Do you?
I think she's asking for how to balance, like, being a professional and being in a relationship. She's saying that when she's single, she's really focused and works hard on progressing professionally. And then when she's in a relationship, she gets distracted. And so it's harder for her to have that same focus and energy, maybe.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't feel like that's a very difficult question. Mm-hmm. I think that's a personality type.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I didn't hear her say anything about being a mom.
Mm-mm.
But it does seem like she's like wants to like be a wife. Mm. Maybe not a wife, but in a relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like she just can't, like, when she has a project, she's focused on that project, and the relationship becomes the project.
Mm. Yeah, I can see that.
I'm trying to think about what I've never seen. I don't know if anybody has done it. I've seen people abandon other relationships.
Yeah.
But I like friendships and like mm-hmm. family, but I've never seen people abandon their job.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know what to say about that.
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like, I wonder if it's a matter of like having an unhealthy, I don't even know if it's fair to say unhealthy, but you know how like some people are so career driven that they can like live, breathe, eat, sleep, do all the things, business. And so then when they get into a relationship, it's hard for them to really figure out how to like merge that in. And so they're trying to So then they ended up just giving all their attention to that. It's kind of like what you said about project-based, but I'm saying like, maybe it's a matter of in her singleness, being able to have better habits of being like, I don't want to say not working so hard, but having, enjoying life and having work life, like work life balance. Does anybody have that?
No. I mean, some people may have it, but yeah. I think this is interesting because I'm realizing that when she is in a relationship, she goes to work and she thinks about the guy. Like she's just smitten. Mm-hmm. Like someone comes over like, hey, are you going to finish those reports? She was like, Jamal told me. Jamal got me flowers. And they were the pink and the red. So they were like pinkish red, but they weren't the white. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
And she's talking about all the things. And her manager's like, okay. But the reports. I don't know. I feel like there is just going to be some unlearning. You know what I'm saying? I think she's going to have to set boundaries, you know, because you still got to eat, you know. Man. And it might be a little bit of, dang, I don't want to say idolatry, but I do want to say there is a level of like, she like really, she be smitten. You know, and I'm probably sure that like that's bad for the guy because the guy's kind of like, I ain't ask you to be like all into me like this, but I love it. And then when she's like, I can't actually get work done, so I got to end this. He's like, wait a minute. I like you. She's like, no, you're bad for me. I can't focus. And he's like, well, dang, this is weird.
Yeah.
So it's definitely, I feel like it's a her issue, which she's admitted. But I do think there's like power in her having very healthy boundaries.
Yeah, for sure.
Because like what happens if she's all about that one person and say if he's really committed to work, she's going to be like, well, you like your work more than me.
Yeah.
That's a rough one, sis. I ain't really got much for you. I think that she might need to go to therapy. Right?
I mean, everybody could use therapy, but
I'm just talking about in this specific thing. I mean, I don't want to just go to everybody. You can go to therapy route, but we really don't have any advice for this person. I think she needs to figure out what the root of her issue is because yeah, there is a,
that's true.
There's something happening in where she starts in this relationship and like other things aren't important. So it's almost like when you're in like middle school and you like see a girl in class and you're just like, I just want to get as close as I can to her. You'll switch seats with me. You know what I'm saying?
My goodness, I remember those days.
Like, switch seats with me, bro. Nah, I like her too, fool. Well, free. We gonna have to fight about it. I got 2 hugs from her today. How many hugs you get? She only gave me 1, but she sat next to me in the other class. And you ain't got this. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's like that. Like, I don't want to do no schoolwork. I just want to go to 5th period. You know? That's what it seems like to me.
That is funny. Yes.
So it's almost like it's a level of immaturity here when it comes to relationships. You know? Or she just kind of got to break through and get past the honeymoon stage. And be in a relationship long enough to be like, yeah, we can function together. And I can still do my work.
Yeah.
Because otherwise, then when things get tough, she's going to want to bail every single time.
Very true. Good stuff. Glad you had something for that. Thanks. Okay. I'm going to move on. Here we go.
Hi, Glen. So I do have... not necessarily a dilemma, but just something that I would like your opinion on. I'm going to try to keep it short because I know that I can get long-winded, but I'm going to try not to. So I am 20 years old, and I'm living in Toronto. I've been with my boyfriend for almost 4 years now. So when we first got together, neither of us were saved, so obviously that led to us getting into some things which I got into. We lost our virginity to each other. I was 17, he was 18. And yeah, so we'll just fast forward to 2019, going into this year, we both got saved, and we've been celibate for going on a year now. So yeah, but through the past couple months, we've been talking about marriage and stuff just because we're both at a point where we just want to glorify God in our relationship. So yeah, we've been kind of like talking about that. My boyfriend is very much like scared or not ready, to be married just because like the one thing for him is he wants to be done school. Whereas I'm like, I'm ready. yeah, I'm not so concerned with like the logistics of everything. And like, I'm okay with going through a struggle period, because I know that that happens in marriage. So yeah, that's one of his like setbacks or something that he's told me that he's not ready, for because of that, because of school. But yeah, so last night we had a conversation and he was just telling me how he's been struggling with like purity in his mind. Pretty much telling me how he's been tempted and how he really has to work hard to control his thoughts. And, yeah, he's been struggling with mental purity, I guess. And then on top of that, he is just like, I'm not ready because I really want to be done school. I want to, you know, move out and have our own place, have our own, you know, life once we get married. And I'm very much just like, let's just do what we should get there later, because we're very much committed to each other. We have, like an accountability, I guess, couple, our pastor and his wife, we've been married for 10 years. And, yeah, we have sat down and spoke to them about stuff, and they just advised us to keep praying and, you know, continue in our courtship. Oh my gosh, I left that out. Yeah, we're courting. We've been courting for, like 4 months now, but like I said, we've been together for almost 4 years. But yeah, so I'm just kind of wondering what you guys think, like, is he right to want to have everything, have, like, ducks in a row before we get married, or am I kind of going crazy with the whole just get married and figure it out? Because I just really want to glorify God in our relationship. Like, that's all I'm interested in. And okay, this is me again. I'm so sorry. I wanted to keep it short so it would be one message, but I just be talking. Yeah, anyways, my question, just because I know I've been talking a lot, my one question is, like, what is your opinion on the whole situation? Do you think that I am right in wanting to just get married and figure it out? Because, like, when I say that, it's not going to be a big struggle. Like, we're both in good financial situations, and, like, it wouldn't be like we're going to be poor or we're going to be on the street or anything like that. And another thing is, oh my gosh, I'm so out of order here. Bear with me, please. He goes to school about an hour and a half away. We're both in university. We're both third year. Oh my gosh, you guys are American. Juniors? Yeah, sorry, I'm Canadian. But yeah, he goes to school about an hour and a half away. And right now, obviously, he's been home for the past like year and a bit, because of COVID and everything, and school is online. But one of his concerns is that when school opens back up, he's going to have to move back to school, and then there'll be that distance. And the first 2 years of our relationship were long distance because he went to prep school in America for football for 2 years. So we've done the long distance, and it's kind of something that we both were like, we don't want to go back into that. so yeah, he's made it kind of clear that he doesn't want to kind of throw his desires out of the way just to satisfy that one part of our relationship of not having to be long distance. But he also doesn't want to put us through the long distance again. So he just, his mind is scrambled. He doesn't know what to do. And neither do I. So let me get back to this. My one question, what is your guys' opinion on our relationship? What do you think should be our next step? I guess which side are you, not that this side, but which opinion are you guys leaning toward? And yeah, I just would love to get your thoughts on our relationship and on our current season of it. Yeah, thank you guys so much for listening, because I know I talk a lot and I babble on, but I appreciate you listening, and I appreciate any response that you could give us. All right, bye!
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, so... okay, that was a lot.
So my initial response is, I don't think either of you is wrong or right or wrong or right. I think that if it's interesting, because I think about me and I think about like how I always would like to, you know, like, okay, first comes this, then comes this, then comes this. Like, Glenn's proposal caught me all kinds of off guard because I was supposed to, like, be having my first year of teaching. I was supposed to have bought a home. Like, I had all these things that I was supposed to do before I got married, and none of that was in place. And so sometimes I feel like as long as you're not being completely irresponsible, it's okay to move forward in those things. But I don't think it's possible for anyone to have it all together before getting married, is my point, I guess. Like we didn't have it all together.
Not at all. Yeah, I don't really understand that.
Understand what?
I want to finish school first.
Mm.
Like, I don't get it.
You know what's so interesting is I went to a university, a Christian university, and people would literally, like, get married their sophomore and junior years, and I'd be like, what is happening?
I don't understand why. Like, why not?
I don't know.
I just don't get it.
Yeah, I don't know.
I mean, I think it's more difficult to have children and be in college.
Yes, very true.
But if you're just married, I don't really know what the difference is. You know what I'm saying? Because you're still going to be working. Well, I guess maybe you lose your parents' insurance or something like that. Or
I don't think that happens. Wait, does marriage make you lose your insurance or age?
Age, but at the same time, like, if you're somebody else's dependent, then I don't think you could be on someone else's insurance or something. I don't know. But if they're both in school, but they're financially fine, I don't see what the big deal is.
What does financially fine mean? Are they living like she's off not of true. Student loans or working jobs?
It doesn't really matter, does it?
Does it not really matter?
Who cares?
Living off student loans is rough. You got to pay those things back.
Yeah, but you still got to live off of them. You're just lonely.
So you, like, live off the student loans
financial alone aid.
Or live off student loans
yeah.
together?
Yeah. I don't know, man. I think it's kind of, I mean, like, but then I start to creep into, like, the, okay, college. What?
What would you say to your children?
If they found someone and they want to be with that person, and but the whole thing is, like, first of all, let's talk about what she's saying, right?
Okay.
She's saying this dude is having trouble with his purity.
Okay.
Marriage is not going to solve that problem.
Yes. Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Like, he's still going to have those issues. Okay. So if that's the reason why you want to get married, then, like, that's not going to help.
It doesn't sound like
it may help, but it's not going to be the thing that cures it.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Mm-hmm.
So just so we know that, like, that's one thing.
Mm-hmm.
But if you guys, like, genuinely love each other and you're grown-ups and you're ready to start making grown-up decisions,
mm-hmm.
like, I don't think school is going to help you. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, okay, I'm done school, now mm-hmm. I can get married. Cool, help me pay off my loans.
Yo, that's a sore spot for Ooh. You. If you was a member of the wedding party, you know.
Well, I'm just saying, like, I don't really understand what the big deal is.
He's like, you might as well enjoy some of those student loans if you're going to have to
I'm trying to tell you. Off. I'm trying to tell you. Like, you have to, like, you might as well start living your life with this person. Because all it is going to be times that you guys just weren't together, but you were together. I don't really get the big deal. Not unless you're trying to, like, all right, we want to have a $20,000, $30,000 wedding and you want to save up for the wedding. I don't know what the big deal is. If you're down to just have a small little situation, just your friends, and it just be you two, and you guys want to start living life together, I don't really know.
That is a really good point, love. I agree with you. I feel like going to college, is that going to make you a better spouse? Graduating from college, is that going to make you a better spouse?
Are you even going to have a job?
Wait.
After you get out of college.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Like, what's the guarantee that school... I think people say this is because they don't get distracted.
Mm.
Like, they may not want to get distracted while in school.
Mm. Very good point.
But if you can manage not being distracted, then I think you'd be fine. But guys, don't take my advice. Because I'm also, like, very much, like...
anti-school.
Very much like, man, college is not really like that. I think college is great for teaching you how to get tasks done. So the people that work for me are amazing. They know how to get tasks done and systems. You know what I'm saying? But as far as like becoming a better person, I don't think college is the lick. You know what I mean? I'm not sure though, because I ain't really go like that. So y'all gonna have to tell me right in. I don't think this is I mean, to each his own, right? If this guy is just like, yeah, I want to finish school first, but that sounds like, to me, that sounds like pressure from parents. Like that's something parents say. Yeah, get married after you're done college, after you're done school. You know what I mean? It's like school ain't going nowhere. School is always gonna be there.
Yeah.
What you think?
I don't know. I'm just thinking, it's interesting because I just literally had a conversation about something similar to this. And it's kind of like, you know, sometimes it's really important for you to make sure you're hearing from the Lord, like what he would have for you to do. And in this case, it would have to be like you both would have to hear from the Lord on how to move forward with this. But I think society can get really busy sometimes and tell us like, this is how you do things like decently and in order. Or even the church can sometimes tell us like what it means to do things decently and in order. But sometimes the Lord has something different for us. And so we have to stay attuned to his voice in that manner. And so I'm just trying to think about me and like if I were to get married as a junior in college, how would I have done? And I don't know. I have no clue.
Yeah, it wouldn't have been no different from your first year of teaching.
Yeah.
It'd have been rough.
Yeah. It also just depends on the type of people who are in a relationship.
Yeah, and your community, like your friends. You know what I'm saying? So, at the same time, it's kind of like, do you think God really care what order you're doing in, or that you glorify him while you're doing it? I don't think God cares. Not unless he's told you specifically, this is the correct order. Now,
the thing is, God has the ability to redeem anything. So if you do things out of his order, then.
But I mean, it's like, okay, then what is God's order? Because here's a question that's going to get me canceled. All right. I'm not even going to go there.
What?
It's out there.
Just go.
I can't. Because then we're going to have to cancel this podcast. And we already canceled. This will be the fourth one. All right, here, I'll say it to you. So, that was out there, huh?
Yeah, we don't want to open that can of worms.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I'm just saying. Okay, so like, God has an order to everything. You know what I'm saying? I just don't think God cares that much about what, I think that's societal pressures. You know what I mean? Like, it's I don't know. I just feel like we get all up in the business there. If Anaya came to me, and this is just me talking as she's three right now, so who knows what I'm thinking. But if she's like, hey, man, like me and this dude's been dating for a long time, we want to get married. You know what I'm saying? Like, I want to finish school, but I'd rather live with him and do it with him in the process. You know, we want to get married. And, you know, she's 19, 20. All right, do your thing. But I ain't paying no more than bills. That's on you and him. Maybe. I don't know. It depends on how petty I'm being at the time. Right? No?
Man, that's hard because I'm imagining like if she's just fresh out of high school, going to college, been dating a guy or whatever. I'm like, because when someone gets married, it is their responsibility to like start their family and establish their own whatever and take care of themselves. Like they're not going to be able to. That would be.
But I
would feel bad making my daughter like have to like. Go to college and work. Okay, this might sound bad. I'm not saying that she shouldn't work, but like really go to college and have to provide for herself in that way.
Really?
Yeah.
But think about our children.
Like I would like her to be able to focus on school, on her academics and like doing well.
Check this out.
And get maybe a side job, not because she like needs it and has to, but because she wants extra money to go treat herself to something occasionally.
That's fine. Now listen. if our children are smart, right, they're going to know my father's business, right? The father's collection. You guys probably missed Plug. It. Right?
They missed it because we was beefing and we didn't talk about it.
All right. So if our children are smart, they already make money. They'll be able to finesse a pretty easy career while if they want to go to college. Because like my plan is like, you can go to college if you want to, but you don't have to because I have certain things, avenues set up for you to, if you want to work for this company, you could work for this company or this company or whatever. By that time, Anaya, if you know, depending on how we do with this belief in fatherhood thing, she could be our own situation to be like, yeah, I'll teach you guys how to study if you join my Patreon group. Like, okay, so yeah.
Who knows what college will look like when she's in college?
She's in the runnings to be set up pretty fine financially, right? So if our daughter came and she was just like, look, man, like I like, me and him have been dating since we were 15. We've done everything that you asked us to do.
I'm really having a hard time thinking.
And you want to move out of my house? Bye. Right?
At 15 years old?
No, I'm saying we're dating since we're 15 and she's 19, 20. I don't know. And I'm, and you know, of course, everyone's going to be like, dude, you're going to be broken. And I know I will.
I'm having trouble just thinking about her at 15.
But I'm just thinking about it. Like, I would have like loved to been set up to do life better. Like at 19, like I didn't know what taxes was. I remember turning 18 and they was like, yeah, dang, you had to freaking sign up for
FAFSA.
No, not that. What is it called when you turn 18 or something like
Voters
that?
Voters registration?
No. It's the thing that, like, if you go to war, selective service.
Oh, my.
And I'm like, what? Yeah, you got to sign up for the selective service or something like that. Yeah.
Because so when you're ROTC.
No, because you're a boy.
Wait, men have to do that?
Men sign up for the selective service at 18. So if there's a draft, you get drafted to war.
No way. That's a thing?
Yes, 100% it's a thing.
Still? Yeah. I know it used to be a thing.
Look. Look, let's look it up real quick.
It's right there.
Selective service. What is it? It's an independent agency of the United States government that maintains information on those potentially subject to military conscription. It's like everybody at the age of what age?
What happens if you don't? Yeah.
If you're required to register and you do not, and you don't, you will not be eligible for federal student aid, federal jobs training, or federal job. You may be prosecuted and face up to a fine of $250,000 or jail time of up to 5 years.
Go to the .gov website. Is this still a thing? Almost all men age 18 to 25 who are U.S. citizens or immigrants living in the United States are required to be registered with selective service. Click on required to be registered. I'm still not
convinced. It's a picture of Theo and Raya sitting there. Almost all male U.S. citizens and male immigrants, right?
It is important to know that even though he is registered, a man will not automatically be inducted into the military. In a crisis requiring a draft, men who would be called in sequence determined by random lot. What? I had no clue this was a thing.
ROTC students, yes. And I was an ROTC student.
That is so bizarre.
Yeah, but anyway.
And why is it just men? How sexist is that?
Yeah. I mean, that's a benefit for y'all. Right?
Somebody's got to stay behind.
Look, I'm just saying that, like, there are certain things that we should have known that we were not required to know because we were learning about Pythagorean theorem.
You didn't even say it right.
We were learning about dumb stuff.
That's true. I'm not going to lie. I mean, that's real.
You know what I'm saying? But like, if we can raise our children to where they, it's not difficult to be like, hey, look, if you own a business and you have to pay employees, here's how you set up an ADP. Like all the stuff we're learning right now, like, you know what I mean? Like, I think it'll be so much more beneficial to be like, okay, yeah, you know what I'm saying? Anaya's 19 or, you know, Uriah or whatever. It's like, yeah, I actually know how to set up, you know, my own LLC, and I have this money and we're going to invest in this and blah, blah, blah. Right. Mm-hmm. So when we do that, like we do have kids who grow up, it's like, yeah, I trust you. If I could trust you to, you know, edit your own videos and, you know, take yourself back and forth to work, like I can trust you to, you know, maintain a home. You know how to do the things. Like, it's really not that hard. It's just all at once. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. We literally found out that we had like student loans, we had to like save for retirement. We had all this debt. We had to get a new car. We had to move out of our houses and all types of stuff. I had to pay taxes, like all within a 5-6 years.
Yeah.
And it all came like a big wave.
Yeah. Yeah, man. I hear you.
So I don't necessarily believe that.
It's just, okay, I think this is the thing for me, is that it's like a leave and cleave. And so if you leave your parents' home, if you decide that here's what I'm going to do, I'm going to move on and, you know, like be wedded with this man or this woman, can you really, like, can the two of you really just stand on your own 2 feet?
I mean, they might. I mean, I think in the first 2 years of marriage, you need help. In our first 2 years of marriage, we needed help.
Financial help?
Heck yeah, man. Your parents paid our first mortgage. I mean, our first rent.
Yeah, because my paycheck didn't come.
Because you had them summer payments.
They did?
Yeah. They paid your first rent, our first rent at Madagual.
Oh, man. Was that their wedding gift?
I think so. Like, we got a lot of help in the beginning. Mm-hmm. You know, they were paying for pizza and they were really helping us out, man.
They did, man.
And that's just a part of growing up. Like, you gonna need 2 years of real help anyway. So we might as well start those 2 years fast. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, if you have the support system that's willing to support you in that way, then totally go for it. But
God willing, we are there. You know what I'm saying? To be a support system for them. And we don't, you know what I'm saying? Like, we continue to go forward with this path of success or whatever this is. You know what I'm saying? Like, hopefully we can get to that point. Mm-hmm. But I'm not banking on my children being incapable of doing stuff. You know what I'm saying? So I really do believe that they will be fine. Mm-hmm. Now, whether or not you finish college, I don't really think it's a big deal. But if you have this plan, then, you know, you can stick to your plan. I just don't think it's necessary. Mm. Like, I'd rather be broke than broke and sexually frustrated.
What are you suggesting?
Suggesting that there's like a connection that those two would have and like a peace. Like, think about, you go home, you're studying, you go home, and then you got this like, we're kind of long distance. I can't see this person. It like adds another level of stress to the situation where you could just like, hey, like, this is a safe haven for me. Mm. You know what I mean? And like, all right, so I'm in college. Not. But when I was in college, right, when I did community college run away before we got together, like, I had assignments, I had a job, and I had to, like, abide by my dad's rules. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And, like, I would get charged per fork that was in the sink. My dad wasn't playing, you know what I'm saying? But he got me to, he's like, man, if I hit you in the pockets, it'll work. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And so that's how I went. Mm-hmm. I don't know, man. I just think, I think it's kind of ridiculous.
But that's our perspective on it. Like, you've heard Glenn, you've heard me. So you got to do what you got
to
do.
I would love to hear the argument for the two people who are sitting there like, you should go to college first and finish college and then get married. I'd like to hear two people sit down and talk about it and justify it. Mm-hmm. Because I'm kind of sitting there like, eh. Mm-hmm. But you're also talking to someone who, you know, I'm very, like, weird. All right, let's go.
I think this email might be a little much for the remaining time that we have.
Well, think about it. We spent a lot of time listening to that girl's thing.
All right. Hi, Glenn and Yvette. I am a long-term subscriber and just love your family so, so much. You are inspiring and funny, and I absolutely love the old videos of Glenn and the kids. Uriah's use of the word brother melts me every time. He still says it. Anyway, I'm 32 years old and I left home at 19 because my dad was very physically violent towards me. I'm the second of four kids, same mom and dad, and for some reason he loved my siblings but just couldn't stand me and hit and taunted me a lot. I'd live in long sleeves even in summer at school to avoid people seeing cuts and bruises. Wouldn't go to A&E when he accidentally cut a hole in my thumb because of other wounds they may see. I would beg my mom to leave him, promising that I'd leave school, get a job, and help with bills if she'd just leave him, but we never did. As a result, I didn't tell anyone when the caretaker of my church molested me. I just didn't trust anyone to help me. I was so used to pretending everything was fine and playing the good Christian girl. I am very close to my mom, and though I had questions about why she never protected me from my dad, she tries occasionally, like she'd take me to work with her if she knew it was a weekday and dad would be home with me. It's a can of worms I didn't want to deal with. Anyway, years later, I started having panic attacks and flashback, insomnia for 13 years, and anxiety issues. I went to therapy, which helped a bit, but essentially, I just needed validation of what I went through from my mother because I doubted and blamed myself a lot. I tried to have that conversation with her and she did just that, validated everything, and it helped a lot. I reconciled with my dad and forgave him. Things improved greatly. However, my mom feels that now we have done so, everything should be just perfect and we need never speak of it again. She was telling me one day that I should write an autobiography about my journey to becoming a child cardiac nurse because it was so crazy. So I told her that if I did that, I'd have to also speak about my dad as it's a life story. As soon as I mentioned that, she backed up. She said no, because the family would be mad at me and my granddad's mother, her dad's mom, would never forgive me. Well, this has just set me back so much. I was ready to tell her about what happened in church, but I realized that regardless of how I feel, silence is demanded if there is a chance the family will be shamed. It solidifies the idea of not being enough or that I am shameful and less important than my siblings. It makes me feel like I shouldn't be so sensitive and hurt because it wasn't a big deal, that the flashbacks, etc., are just signs of my lack of strength. Whew. It is not that I desire to expose my life to the world, but having another shame me into keeping quiet is what hurts and haunts. My dad and I have reconciled, but it doesn't change the damage done 19 years of abuse. I love my mom and I need her desperately. I am strong and capable, but I am aware that of the fact that I can't lose her. She's my safe space. Nevertheless, I am also aware that keeping secrets my whole life has caused issues only God can fix. I don't know what to do for the best. I'm a Christian and I do pray, of course. I know I should be worried for nothing, but I am worried. Any advice would be greatly appreciated.
Yeah, man. I felt so much of that. That was real.
I'm fighting back tears.
You know, that whole, like, you just need someone to justify.
Not justify, but like say that it happened.
Yeah, like validate. Like
acknowledge.
Because you also make yourself feel crazy.
Yes.
Like that is real.
Yeah.
And no one sees it. No one wants to say it's real. And everybody just wants you to get over it because it's inconvenient. That is real, man. One thing. I feel like I'm a liberator in that sense, to where it's kind of like, you know, it's no longer your story when it happens to me. You know what I'm saying? Like, how can I protect someone who's not trying to protect me, you know? So when it happens to you, it's your story now.
It's no longer your story when it happens to me.
Yeah. So I like, it may not be a part of your story, but it's a part of mine.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And I think your story is beautiful. You know what I'm saying? As terrible as it is, the fact that you've become who you are, but I think you need to say it in order for you to believe it. You know what I'm saying? In order for you to be proud of yourself. Because what's happening is this situation is like saving face for family and saving face for the community, or may hurt some feelings, but it's also like literally giving you it's a physical reaction. You know what I'm saying? You're dealing with things that you can't control. You know what I mean? So you're like, why is this popping up in my health? You know what I'm saying? Like, why am I getting anxiety? You know? And it's almost like, if you're a nurse, and I think she's a cardiac nurse or something like that, right?
Yeah. Pediatric, so, cardiac, and respiratory.
Right. So if there's something that one of your patients is doing that's further causing them to have these negative effects on their health, then you would tell them to stop doing that. You know what I'm saying? Mm. But they can't stop doing it if they don't know what they're doing. You know what I mean? So they have to, one, recognize the ills that they're doing to themselves. And then they have to, like, rectify. You have to recognize and then rectify. Right. Mm. So you're willing to rectify, but you have to also recognize. Mm. But you can't rectify what you don't recognize. So I think that you forgiving someone and then you allowing, like, forgiving someone is like super important, but also not putting yourself in a position so you can have that same hurt done to you again. That's even more important. And sometimes silence is abuse. Like sometimes like pretending that, like, dang, it's like pretending that this didn't happen to you is also them like denying a part of who you are. So it's like, we accept this part of you, but not the hurt part. You know mm-hmm. what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And so not even your full identity is welcomed in the family to save face and keep other people. Mm. You know what I mean? There's going to be things that our children do, you know what I mean, that we're going to have to recognize. There's things that I've done that I have to recognize. And then things that people have done to me that I have to be like, yo, I can't allow you to do that to me again. So we could be cool, but I still can't be in your presence. Mm-hmm. Because I don't know what I'm going to do to you if you do it again. Mm. Like, not alone, like you doing it to me. Mm-hmm. Like, I might burn the whole thing down. And so everybody's safe. I can't be around you. Mm-hmm. Because no one is reconciled or no one has validated my feelings. Like, it makes me go back to the child I was when it happened. And if I swing as that child, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. It's mm-hmm. a lot different from swinging as a grown man. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Very so I can't so. Be in that situation. So, man, I recognize this in you. And I feel like this is still a part of your journey and your journeying. You have something to say? Mm-mm. And I would say that you should definitely write that. At least write it.
Yeah, you know? At the very least, write it.
Yeah, at least write it. But you don't need permission from your mom. You know, you don't need permission from your mom. You don't need permission from your dad, your grandma, none of those people. But you need to give yourself permission. None of those people will ever be satisfied with anything you do. You know, they're trying to protect the abusers. And that is very dangerous. And they could still love that person and still know that about them. And that's what I think is wrong. Like, we're afraid to know or believe something about someone, you know, because it changes our perspective of them. But it also doesn't allow that person to, like, be healed. Mm. You know? So if everybody recognizes,
yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like, cause man, I'm gonna be honest with you, man. Like, I like really feel bad for Bill Cosby. Like, I'm not saying that he's a good guy, mm-hmm. but like, I've always known him as like the dad. Mm-hmm. And part of my childhood is tarnished because of what he decided to do. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I could still recognize that he did horrible things. You know what I'm saying? But like, I can still feel bad for him. Mm-hmm. And that doesn't make me evil because I feel bad for him. Like, I feel worse for the victims, but I still look at him like, dang, man, like, what happened to you? You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm curious. Like, what happened to you, dog? What did you do that for? What urged you to do that? Why? You know, and I want to know. I feel like I need to know why. You know what I mean? But I think that we try to categorize people and put them so much on to be like, no, he's a rapist, and we don't need to ever hear from him again, and we're only giving microphones to the victims. You know what I'm saying? It was kind of like, we actually probably need to understand what this dude was thinking so we could recognize in another man when it happens.
Wow.
Or before it happens.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, that mind needs to be studied. Because if someone was there to hold him accountable and grab him by his ear or punch him in the neck, you know what I'm saying? And mm-hmm. say, hey man, we don't tolerate that behavior. I don't care how much fame or clout you got.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we need to recognize that you got issues that you need to go in, you need to be in therapy for, or you need to get body slammed, because that is BS.
Mm-hmm.
But like we want to keep quiet and save face. And that sucks. I don't know much about Harvey Weinstein, but I'm sure it's the same for him. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, or Russell Simmons. I don't know. You know what I'm saying? R. Kelly or Jeffrey Epstein.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? It's like, I don't know. I don't know much about a lot of those men. I'm only thinking about Bill Cosby because he was like such an influence in my life. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? But like, I don't have the mind, right? Like, I have a heart for this woman, right? Because I know her.
Yeah.
But I feel like I know her because she talks to us all the time. But, like, her story, your story needs to be told, right? Because no one's able to recognize what's happening in your father. You know what I mean? And those type of men, they get hard passes. They get like, man, he'll be fine. And then when they get old, you know, they kind of come to terms with themselves and they're just like, man, grace, humility, or whatever. But that's still no reconciliation for you. You know what I mean? And so how you're dealing with it in day-to-day life can be traumatic, and it'll also come up in ways that you actually, what do they call, microaggressions?
Micro message, meta message.
No. What Jason said the other day.
Oh.
Like, remember he was talking about the microaggressions of being like, you don't know, like you may meet someone, right? So she's 32, right?
Mm-hmm.
So she may meet someone that has certain things about her that remind her of her father.
Mm-hmm.
And when he does something, it's going to act like, she's going to feel like she was abused again.
Mm-hmm.
Because she just noticed. Like, I've seen women on the comment section be like, yeah, I recognize that. My ex-husband did that and he beat me when I said something to you, because mm-hmm. it triggered them. It's a mm-hmm. microaggression.
Mm-hmm.
And so like, you may not ever really get full deliverance if you don't like hold people accountable to this. I feel like your life has been convenient for a lot of people but yourself. Like Your life is convenient for your dad. Your life is convenient for your grandma, convenient for your mom. But it's not like your pain needs to be convenient for you. You know what I'm saying? And this church person, like, I think you got it.
They need to be called out.
I think everybody, the whole thing got to be set on fire. But that's mm-hmm. me. That's me, right?
Yeah.
And I could get real crazy about that type mm-hmm. of stuff. You know what I'm saying? So I wouldn't do it the way I would do it, but I would definitely do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
When I was reading this email, I was reminded of a post I encountered on Instagram the other day, and it said, one day you will tell that story about how you overcame that battle you went through, and God will send you the exact people who need to hear that story. And it's interesting because my mom has often shared with me about how, like, sometimes she has experienced things in her life and she just didn't really understand why God would allow her to, like, go and walk through some of those things. But in her, like, in the season that she's currently walking through, she is now encountering the people that needed to have her experience those moments in her life in order to help them walk through that current season in their own life. And so, I don't know, I feel that way about everybody's story. Like, even me, I'm realizing that I have a story to tell. And it's nothing like yours, girl. It's nothing like yours. But I definitely think everything that Glen said is completely on point with how you should process through this. And I'm proud of you for being in therapy, too, because this is a lot to have to work through.
Yeah, I ran across a message to a post, and it said, marriage is hard. Divorce is hard. Choose your heart.
I saw that, too.
Obesity is hard. Being fit is hard. Choose your heart. Being in debt is hard. Being financially disciplined is hard. Choose your heart. Communication is hard. Not communicating is hard. Choose your heart. Life will be easy. Life will never be easy. It will always be hard, but you can choose your heart wisely. So it's hard living like you're doing right now. You know what I'm saying? And like choosing not to say anything and choosing to protect the people who hurt you.
Mm-hmm.
But it's also hard to do the opposite and to call them out. So basically you're just choosing whichever way you want to go. You know what I mean? So either way, it's going to be difficult. Yeah. We feel for you.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
How married are you?
Oh. I'm so married that I solved a... I'm going to just keep it at this. I woke up earlier than I was supposed to solve a very vicious insect problem that we had. What time was it?
I asked you to be up at 7. You were up at like 6.
Yeah.
Maybe 6:30.
You texted me. It was like, hey, if you're up, we got a very vicious insect problem that would completely interrupt a shindig we were having at the house.
Mm-hmm.
And I got up.
And he literally put his life in danger because he did not handle it responsibly. You could have been severely harmed.
I chose my heart.
You did. You chose your heart, babe. Thank you so much.
How married are you?
I'm so married that I was at this store and I saw this shirt.
Yeah.
And I said, he has to have it.
I'm a big Office fan, guys. And so I have a shirt on that says Dunder Mifflin Inc.
Paper company.
Yeah. I appreciate that.
You're welcome. And that's just how married we are. We made it.
Finally.